Kristen Shiner McGuire, with whom I have worked at Nazareth longer than I think either one of us would care to remember. But she is a fantastic performer and a very good colleague and really an expert percussionist in all sorts of ways. So I just would get started right away with her presentation, except I would say that those of you who are going to dinner, if you're driving, I've given you the presenters who are going to dinner with us, I've given you a little map. Just please stand in the back door there and see who can take everyone over to Benucci's. We have to be out by 6:30. So I will say just fill up your car and go in this direction and look for the reservation under my last name, Roth, and we will all eventually get there at the same time. Okay, Kristen.
Great. Could you ask the people who are driving to raise their hands?
The people who are driving, could you raise your hands? I'm driving, and Kristen's driving.
I can take four.
And I can take three.
I can take three.
So I think we'll make it.
Or six if they're plural.
Okay.
Wow. Good afternoon, everybody.
Hello.
Hi. I know that you've had, that those attending the conference have had a fairly long day of presentations sitting in one room, right? Okay. Isn't this exciting? You have to be in a different room. Yes. And this room has windows. So. Great. I am so honored to be able to be a presenter, and I'd like to thank Marjorie Roth for inviting me and for Elizabeth Wells for organizing this this whole conference. Very exciting. This is my 35th year at Nazareth College as the head of the percussion program. I love my work, and every day I wake up happy to come to work here. As Marjorie said, I'm also a performer in a number of different styles of music. I'm a drum set player. I play in the RPO. I play in chamber groups. And I've been able to play musicals for a lot of part of my life. And I love playing musicals. Our students also get a chance to play them here on campus. We now actually have paid positions for our musicals over in the theater department, which is really cool. So I'm going to attempt to read from my outline here, show you a PowerPoint. This is the only second PowerPoint I've ever done, and I thank ahead of time. This is Noah Jones, who's a senior in music therapy. He's going to be my right-hand guy. He has been for a long time helping me. So I have an interesting perspective on West Side Story and musicals and Broadway in general. So I saw the original Broadway production of West Side Story in New York City as a little girl. My father, Ray Shiner, was the woodwind doubler in the pit. He played the original show. He brought home the record, and I listened to it over and over as I did with the Broadway records he brought, all the Broadway records he brought home. I could sing every song and recognize every piece. Other musicals my dad played during childhood, and these were the originals, Fiddler on the Roof, A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum, Superman, and Cabaret. So that was my life. As a little girl. At that point, I had no idea I was going to become a musician and go on to play myself. I also got a chance to play A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum at the Auditorium Theater with Mickey Rooney starring in it years later. So, in 2011, I was hired to play the traveling show of West Side Story at the Auditorium Theater. I was thrilled and terrified at the same time. Although I knew the sound of every song, that was a far cry from actually performing the percussion parts. The original orchestration was for four percussionists, but the percussion part in the pit needs to be covered by one player. This is in addition to the drum set part played by a separate player. Fortunately, I had played many musicals up to this point and had a repertoire of problem-solving skills along with the playing techniques for a variety of instruments. West Side Story proved to be the most difficult I've ever played. And if you search the internet for other people commenting on this percussionist, they will say it's one of the most difficult shows. My colleague Brian Stotts of the RPO is the usual person to get called to play the auditorium theater shows. And his favorite show to play is Wicked, and that calls for 50 instruments. So he's had to be very inventive in his playing of that show as well, building stands and things, putting a xylophone up here above the microphone, for example. So, the first thing I'd like to start with is just showing you a picture of the album that I grew up with, the recording called Bernstein Conducts Symphonic Dances from West Side Story, and also on that album was Symphonic Suite from On the Waterfront. So, there's the album I grew up with. I'm so glad I kept all of these. My father is playing the opening motif on the alto sax. So if you have this, boo-wee-boo-dee-day, on alto sax, that's my dad playing that. And another interesting thing happened when I was getting ready for this presentation. I thought, I wonder if I know, if I could figure out who played percussion on this recording, right? Because I know percussionists from around the world from going to conferences every year. My conference is Percussive Art Society. So I called a friend and I realized that Arnie Lang, who is still living in New York City, wonderful percussionist with the New York Phil, other orchestras, and also an instrument producer. In July 2018, I spoke with him, and he reported that he played bongos and mallet percussion. Herbie Harris was the contractor and played drums. He told me that Herbie Harris was Bernstein's usual drummer for all of his shows, so evidently he called the same person to do the job for that. Buster Bailey was on toms and Walter Rosenberger on mallets. And incidentally, the latter two percussionists were also in the Sauter Finnegan Jazz Orchestra with my father. Anybody here ever heard of the Sauter Finnegan Jazz Orchestra? It was a jazz orchestra in the 50s. It wasn't famous only because they didn't do dance music, but they were extremely innovative. And actually, the sleigh bells I have up here are from that Sauter Finnegan Orchestra. So it's interesting that the two percussionists were in a jazz group and also on Broadway with West Side Story. So there's a pervasive influence of the percussion parts for this show in the 60s for percussionists in several spheres. There is a legacy from 1964 when it opened and continuing today. So the next thing I'd like to show you is, I looked in my own journal, so Percussive Notes is the main journal for the Percussive Art Society, and I found that there were 11 articles. Oh, there's me, I forgot. So that's a picture of me in the pit in 2011 with my setup. So I searched for West Side Story in under Symphonic in Percussive Notes online, and I found 11 citations, which is quite a bit because we cover every single aspect of percussion in the world. So let's go to the next slide. Not you can read all these, I just sort of wanted to show you the listing. There's one page and the other page of references. Also, I discovered that we have Facebook groups that are devoted just to people that play percussion in shows. So recently, this summer, I got to play Holiday Inn music by Irving Berlin, and I just decided, oh, I'll post. I joined the group and I posted some things on there and got some interesting responses from people I haven't seen for a long time. So there is, this is just to show you the picture of musical theater, percussion, and drum talk. One of the things people do is they post their setups to help other people problem solve, like, how did you figure out that setup? Because that's a lot of what we do. And sometimes to impress people, and sometimes to help people. Could be both, probably. All right, so let's go to, now YouTube also show how pervasive it is. So in this case, we're gonna flip over to, this actually after I titled my talk, I discovered there was a YouTube video with the same title. This guy put a, is it called a GoPro? My students know. Okay, he put a camera on and decided to show what he does. And what's interesting is you see the camera shift all the time. That's how many times he's looking back and forth, probably to the conductor, to the next part, or where are my xylophone mallets? Did I remember my triangle meter? While he's playing the vibraphone. Yelling at his band, which are very funny and contain lots of expletives. That was part of his personality. So I just thought I'd show just a little bit of the next clip. just so you can hear like a jazz version of this. He took the whole suite and wrote an arrangement for his jazz band. So if you don't know who Buddy Rich is, one of the most famous jazz drummers in the world. Messiah in a church, and a woman in the back row came up afterwards and said, "Those sound awful." So I sold them. Yeah, they didn't. They don't work. If I don't own it, how do I get it? So that's my first question. Number two, how will I transport it? Who will pay for the transportation? So if when I'm hired, they will often give me or let me know if I can have a cartage fee on top of everything else, right? So I have to think way ahead. What kind of space will be allotted? What shape is the space? And what are my lines of sight to the conductor? So I practiced, you know, in sort of a shape like this in this room, and then the rehearsal was in the lobby of the auditorium theater, right? But then I got in the pit, and it was a half moon shaped. So I was in the corner. So I had to adjust everything that I practiced. I kind of got used to one shape, so it could be a circle, a square. Sometimes people have to spread out in the line. I remember Noah had a thin, sort of a narrow bandwidth, right?
Yeah.
For a show over in Callahan, and had to set things up like this and walk back and forth. If you're tall like Noah, you can put things up like this. I'm limited, I can only go so far with my arms, so I usually have to pull it around myself. So I had to adjust to the shape of the pit once I got in there and then make some more adjustments. The next element would be score studying and listening. So which parts are the most essential in my orchestrating the written score and musical intent? So since it was written for four people originally, I really have to listen carefully to see what are the most important parts that I have to play, because I'm going to have to leave something out, right? Number two, what combinations of sounds can I create to make the fullest sound? For example, Bernstein actually wrote for the timpani to be played with maracas. He was a brilliant orchestrator. Every single thing he wrote is idiomatic for the instrument and adds something, you know, important to the score, right? Amazing. He was also an amazing orchestrator, as I said, perhaps in part due to the fact that he was also a conductor. So then I have the initial gathering of instruments, two timpani, xylophone, vibraphone, timbales, bongos, four pitch drums, tam-tam, two cowbells, three woodblocks, two triangles, maracas, güiro, and suspended cymbal. So I need to figure out how to play all of those things at a certain time, right? And then fit them in that space. And then I have to figure out how many copies of my music do I want. I don't want too many because I can get lost. I've noticed from, you know, going from over here to over here, I have to then find my place in the piece of music, right? So I have to sort of orchestrate that as well, where I'm going to look. Speaking of going back a little bit, the line of sight of the conductor, so the last show I did, I think it's common now to have little TV screen. So when I had to turn around, I worked with Corinne Aquilino, who was our music theater director here. When I had to turn around from seeing this camera over here, there was another screen. So sometimes we have to just look at a video screen of someone doing this. And in some cases, when the setups are too big, we're in a completely different room and we're segregated and we have to look at a camera. So that's a little weird too, right? Because you sound like you're part of the orchestra, but you're not really physically there, right? The other things that I need besides this stuff are, I need how many music stands, 5 music stands, towels, mallets for vibes, timpani, xylophone, tam-tam, double-ended sticks. Another question I ask myself, are there any parts I can ask the drum set player to cover in spots, right? So I'm going to know how busy that part's going to be. So maybe I'm not going to play the timbales, but the drum set player can do that. And I will ask that person, he or she may or may not be willing to do that. Usually the drummer travels with the show. And I played Motown, and I had to play congas. Now, I'm not a conga player. I play, but I can't play for like 10 minutes without my hands hurting. So I tried to get away with playing with gloves, and the drummer came over and said, no, can't do that. So things that we invent, I brought these to show you. These are called conga slaps. So you can get a similar sound on the congas by using these things. This is made by a company. When I call for sleigh bells, I mounted these on a stick, mounted these on a rope. Typically, we might use these. These are super important. I played Les Mis, I played the drum set and percussion book. I never put these down. I could play all the cymbal rolls and the timpani parts with one part, and then play my snare drum with the other half. Something else that we... This was invented by my colleague. His name is Billy Miller. He's a well-known percussionist and inventor, evidently. I think he's a millionaire now. He invented this thing. It's called the Miller Machine. You never have to pick up the triangle beater. You just mount this next to wherever you're playing and do that. And I'm pretty sure every percussionist in the pit on Broadway uses one of these things. So I'm glad I have one of those. This, as Noah pointed out, would be somebody else invented, like this is a combination stick. So you can play with sticks, but it's got maracas on the inside. And jingles. Two sounds. So just briefly, the way I work on my setup is I start with the individual songs and I see if the movement from instrument to instrument works. Then I try to segue from one song to the next one. Sometimes I'm lucky there's a break, sometimes there isn't a break and I have to go right from one song to the next one. One of the trickiest things to do is make sure that the timpani are tuned for every song. Mm-hmm. So you have to write in all of the tuning changes, and having gauges on the timpani is very helpful for that. What mallets and changes do I need? Can some mallets have dual or triple purpose? As you'll see when I play today, I'm going to be playing the timpani with my xylophone mallets, because it's basically I just need to make a sound on those drums. It's not about getting the perfect sound. What things can be mounted or modified when I don't have time to pick them up? How many copies of music do I need? And then typically there'll be at least 10 changes from the original setup to the final one in practice sessions. So I'll start with one, I'll try to play it, I'll keep tweaking it as I'm working on it. And then there will be several more after I get into the pit because the shape is going to be different in there. Let's see, slide 12. Oh, okay, I don't know, we can just take a look at this briefly. You're not supposed to put this much text on a slide. Yeah. I thought it was interesting. This is from a fellow that obviously he's been on tour playing West Side Story, and he still works every time he plays it. He works on refining all the different changes he needs to do and what he can play with one hand and foot, and he tries to make each performance a little better than the next. And this is a veteran, someone's been doing it over and over again, but still trying to refine it. But actually, for people that play these shows over and over, you really do have to find things that really keep it interesting, right? Because you have to do so many performances as well. So refining your craft, that's a good thing. And then I took a picture of his setup, which is next. So this is his setup. For the touring company. Those things under the bongos, it's kind of cool. Those are like faux congas or something, maybe. So you notice they don't have the shells, so companies have made things without shells, so they take up less space, but you still get the same sound. And notice he's layering things. He put the vibraphone there. He's found a way to put the xylophone and the bells above the vibraphone. Vibes always have to be on the ground because there's a pedal. The other things can be set above here. All right, let's go. What do we have next? Okay. This is just a picture before I show you the score samples. So let's look at some score samples. you could see that those are four parts, and maybe my students are using these parts in their orchestra version, I'm not sure. But I had to pick from those, or sometimes I have an arrow going from one line to the next. Keep going. Yeah, that's one of the busier sections where those were the original five parts that were written, and then the percussionist has to, again, condense that. There may be some touring books where they've condensed it for you already, but usually I see handwriting from the guy or the person that played before me, and I usually use that as, oh, that's probably a good idea. I'm going to try that first if there's still pencil stuff in there. Keep going. The interesting part for America, he writes the clave pattern against quarter note triplets for the other player. So that, you definitely need to practice that coordination between those two parts if you're going to do them. And both parts are important. And I forgot which piece this is from, but you can also see, you have to pick, am I going to play the bongos, the conga, or the pitch drums, or the xylophone. Sometimes I don't have to play the xylophone, like if the woodwinds are playing all those parts, I can go and do the drums. And I found a couple more today, let's look at one more. Oh, I love the writing on this. Okay, this is typically what I'll get. If I get the book for a show, this is all the stuff that's written in, and then I write in more stuff on top of that. I love this example because it goes bum 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 digga digga da. So I feel pretty. You guys know that song, right? So you have to pedal the timpani, bum 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 digga digga da, and play the tambourine right after that. So you'll discover that you've got to mount your tambourine and play it with your timpani mallets after figuring out how to pedal that part. And then we always write in our the note changes. My students are familiar with this. Let's go to one more, so that's the counteract. So there's the mambo. That's the condensed version of the mambo. Those letters D to B and F sharp to B, those are timpani changes, so you change pitches whenever you have a measured rest, you have to do that. And Noah took a picture. This is Noah's setup. He's going to be playing in the orchestral suite tonight, as all my students are, I think, many of them. So he set up the timpani as his main instrument, and then he's got the glockenspiel and the conga and maracas kind of around there.
Right. Yeah, I also have a police whistle on there that you can't see.
Oh.
Or you can just wear it so that way you don't have to worry about trying to pick it up.
That's right. I brought my police whistle and forgot to put it around my neck. It really hurts my ears, so I'm not going to play it. But there is a part where you can hear I have two measures rest where normally I would be putting it in my mouth and blowing it and then hitting the timpani. We'll pretend I'm doing that today. Got a couple more and then I'll do a little playing. So this is a little dark, but that's one setup image, and then we'll go one more. That was in the pit. So also, besides the instruments, of course, they've got microphones, and then you've got, I think it's kind of a handicap. There's lights just on your music, so it's kind of dark in that area as well, so, you know, finding your way around in the dark, and, you know, on the mallet keyboard when it's not fully lit, you practice in a fully lit room, but then you add darkness on top of it. I think, are we up to slide 23? Okay, so we're going to go back one, but we'll look at that yet. Great. Any other questions? Comments? Yes?
So, with everyone in such close quarters, have you ever had some physical mishaps in the pit?
Not too many, but there's a joke, like someone will throw something on my timpano and make it look like I made the sound. Like bonk, you know, like a paper wand, that happens, but not too many. Yeah, there are a lot of tech people there that have been helping us, like at Merry-Go-Round is where I played this last summer, but well, that's a good question. Yeah, it is pretty close quarters as possible. Any other questions or comments? Great, I'm gonna do part of the prologue for you. So you're going to turn all the way up, right?
Yeah.
Sorry, this is... it depends. When the piece, the orchestra version, you're going to see the suite, like when we do with the RPO, you're going to see it tonight. There's just several people. Yeah, but it's pretty amazing. Again, there's also a drum set player filling in some of those things, but you really have to work together. And I'm not really using my feet here, but in Holiday Inn, there was a tune that I played the foot pedals on the drum set and played the conga at the same time. So don't forget, we have feet too. Any comments or questions about anything? Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I have a question because I hear horror stories about this too. I have a friend who does this in London. And
oh, okay.
He always talks about the people, poor drummer who's hired from Hamilton. Has to go computer patch stuff in addition to
all the what?
All the computer patches.
Oh like, my gosh! Please don't ask me to do that. Yeah, I know some drummers have to do that.
So like, there's some shows that just have this aura of notoriety. I'm wondering if there's any of this is particular, like this show or Bernstein's orchestrations. Rather than just sort of like things that are sort of the challenges that are natural to a percussionist in a pit versus anything that's special about this.
I think there's a certain degree of this to every show.
Yeah.
Students that have played shows, would you agree? There's some element of this. This is particularly complicated because it was written for four people. But if you add in electronics, that's sort of a different, sort of the modern version of what I'm doing right here. And then you have to have all that skill set. You have to have a knowledge of how to do the programming and change the patches and, you know, to pre-program that thing. So, you know, you can, if you have a set of pads, it's like a computer or like a keyboard, you can program a number of sounds. If you need chimes, you hit the chimes pad, you can get chimes. And you don't have to, chimes are like one of those things you don't want to have to try to fit in the pit. So getting the keyboard player to play the chime part is usually a good idea. Yeah.
So like you said, like Latin orchestration isn't necessarily any more of a challenge than any other pit orchestra role. It's still, you know, 10 feet to 20 ones.
No, it may be a little bit more. This one may be, it's the most famous for problem solving as I research this.
Yeah,
although I haven't like researched things like Hamilton, for example, so I don't even know. I know Miss Saigon, I had some high school students in high school playing that. Those call for really interesting instruments that are very hard to find. So the problem there is you have to find things that approximate Vietnamese instruments. You know, you have to know what the desired sound is and then make something up that sounds sort of like that, right? Yes.
I'm interested, you were getting the timpani with knowledge you wouldn't usually use on timpani, right? So, I mean, the sound was harder.
Right.
Was it?
But mostly it's just about getting the note in the right spot.
So the conductor doesn't say, oh, I don't like that sound.
No. The conductor's happy you played it at the right time. Okay. Yeah. However, I mean, I chose here because it's so fast. I didn't want to flip my mallets over. I do have a set that's Glock on one end and timpani on the other. And I could flip them. I just chose, you know, I don't want one more thing to think about, so I'm not going to do it. It's because I have to change the pitches, too.
You got all of them.
Yeah, no, that's a good point. Yeah, it is possible the conductor will say something, but usually not, I would say. Yeah, but it's in the mix, you're getting the sound in the right spot, and that's really what you need, right? So I've invented a little setup here, and I would like someone to, it's called Instant Pit Percussionist. Let's go to the next slide. There are four stations. There's the first station. Do I have a volunteer to come up? Here's the music. So you're going to step. This is station one. You're going to play the claves. And then you have to count six beats and walk over here and play the xylophones. And then count eight beats. Walk over here and play the bass drum. And the thing is, you have to break out one mallet. You can't play the part because there's a roll. And then the last segment, you have to play the vibra slap and with a triangle note. Okay, and we're going to put a metronome on the cabinet. Quarter note equals 90. Who wants to try? Non-percussionist.
Wait, did you say you wanted four volunteers or what?
One. Put it on 76. Actually, let's do it without a metronome first. Okay. Yeah.
Practice is a thing.
Oh. Without a metronome. All right, this brave soul. Woo! We'll do it without. Let's go back to the slide. So we're going to see. What is your name?
Martha.
Martha. Hi, Martha. Welcome.
Hi, thank you.
Instant percussionist, add water or add something. Add bravery.
Do I get
great technique on where to hit the ball with?
No. Yes. It doesn't really matter. These are just, yeah. Okay, so she's going to have to play the, I like to be an America theme. And she's got to count six beats and then go over to the xylophone and play a little melody.
And then where do I put these so it can keep playing?
Or actually, you have a cloth right here.
Oh, cloth!
The cloth, that's good. And then you got the bass
player,
you got to roll.
Four beats, and we have to have dynamics.
Dampen and then you gotta hit it twice. Okay, great. Then you're up. This is a virus slap. How do you do that? Okay, three times, and then you have a triangle.
Okay. Yeah, triangle. We have 2 inches of rest, and we don't have the ink machine. We don't have the mold machine.
No, you would have to pick the triangle up. Make it hard. I want you to have to pick it up. That's it.
Triangle, fiber slap. I need a highlighter. Okay. Okay. It's like bowling. The goal is sometimes just to be bad at it and have fun. So how many bars do I get for the...
So if I give you the quarter note...
That's the 120. That you said 76. It's a practice tempo.
All right.
Okay.
So I'm giving her the quarter note, and then if you kind of change the slide, but she goes to the next note.
Yeah.
Noah.
Yep.
Okay.
Dun, dun, dun. Okay. Right. So that's 6/8. So that's quarter note.
Yeah.
So
she has to think in polyrhythm already. Into that.
Dang it, polyrhythm. So we have Clovis. Those are for that. So these are going to put these over there for now. Okay.
Okay. It worked. She's having to think like a percussionist. What do you normally play or sing or?
I'm a composer and I sing.
Okay.
And I write academic papers. Woo!
Yes.
PowerPoint.
We're ready.
Right. So we can. Beat. One.
Yes. One, two, three, four, five, six.
No, those are the chords.
Thank you so much for taking the time to come this afternoon.
Thank you.